Mountain View.
Welcome to the Mountain View Church of Christ. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God. And now, open your heart and receive the inspired word, the spoken word, the engrafted word, the living word.
I don't know about all of us, but I know many of us believe that in order for our faith to be effective, it must be equal to or larger in size than the challenges that we face. If you and I are confronted with a big problem, we, many of us at least, believe that in order to deal with a big problem, I must in turn possess a big faith. I want us to move from that particular thinking into a thinking that I believe is more biblically centered. I want you to believe with me tonight that it is not the size of my faith as it is, it relates to my problems, to my circumstances, to my situations. I want you to believe like me tonight that it is not the size, but rather the power. Amen, amen, amen. Because many times I am dealing with stuff that I don't quite understand. And because I don't quite understand it, I really don't know exactly what I am having to deal with. But I want you to know tonight that regardless of whatever it is you may be going through, it is not the size of your faith that makes the difference, but rather the power of your faith. Jesus says it is the grain of a mustard seed. It is in fact one of the smallest seeds that man even knows exists. But even though it may be the smallest, it packs a mighty punch. Amen, amen. I'm going to try to hurry up. I'm going to try to get on through it. Amen, somebody. But you know, Jay told me to be timely. But if you act like you don't understand the words that are coming out of my mouth, I'm going to talk to you till you do. Amen. Because many of us, we're dealing with so many different problems. Some of us right now, our loneliness, amen, somebody. Some of us desperately, amen, somebody. Yeah, some of us are in some bad marriages, amen. You know, I tell folk all the time, you're just waiting for, you know, that magical fantasy land called Grounds to appear. And if you ever find yourself in Grounds, amen, you may do something about your marriage. Amen. Okay, so everybody in here, marriage is good. Okay. All right. Well, you know, let's just keep it. You know, some of us are underemployed. Some of us are dealing with unemployment. Amen. Some of us are having to deal with financial woes. Some of us are barely making ends meet. Some of us, amen, we have borrowed from folk till we got nobody else to borrow from. But I want you to know tonight that regardless of what you are dealing with, if you possess a faith that can make a difference, if you possess a faith that is full of power, God will be moved on your behalf. Amen, amen. And we're going to talk. Y'all looking brand new. Okay. All right, let me show you something. Let's look at this principle. Go on, turn over to Mark chapter number 9. Starting at verse number 23, it's in the text, but I only want to deal with a particular principle and concept. Here, this is a father who has come to Jesus because his son is possessed with an unclean spirit. This man has an issue with his son. He has come to Jesus. He has a problem that he believes only Jesus can handle. Yeah. Amen. Uh-huh. So that's part of the power. Yeah. Part of the power is understanding that only Jesus can. So this father comes and Jesus says to him in verse number 23, if you can believe. The question is, can you believe tonight? He doesn't say if you believe. He said, is it possible for you to believe that I can? Can you believe tonight? Can you believe in your heart of hearts that whatever you're having to deal with, Jesus can take care of it? And so Jesus says, can you believe? He says, all things are possible to him who believes. Whatever it is you're having to deal with, it is possible for the power of God to be wrought in whatever you're dealing with. And God can turn that thing right side up. The question is, can you believe? You done went in there, and the doctor has given you some bad news, but I want you to know that only God can heal. But the question is, can you believe? Because Jesus says all things are possible to him that believes. So let me go on and deal with this before I forget. So let's stop copping out. Amen. We cop out real quick. We'll go to God in prayer. We'll go to him with whatever we're having to deal with. And we assume that the reason why God hasn't moved is because... See, we got a bad view of God. I no longer see God as punitive. Y'all know what the word punitive means? I no longer see God like the Greeks and the Romans. I no longer see him like Gentiles do. I no longer see him like unbelievers and heathens do. I now understand that my God is not willing that any should perish. He's not sitting in heaven giving me a hard road to hold, giving me difficult circumstances to see, you know, if I will fall and if I will fail. I believe that God is sitting in heaven. He's coaching me. Amen, somebody. He's encouraging me. He's trying to bless me. Amen, somebody. And so we got a messed up view of God. You know, you listen to half of the folk. You go and ask them advice about what you're having to deal with, and they'll start talking and they'll start speaking death into your stuff. Y'all don't understand. Jesus lets us know that it is the Spirit that gives life. And if we are spiritual people, we ought to be a people that speak life. But we speak so much death. Well, you know, they said such and such and such and such. And boy, I tell you, we sure need to pray. You sound like you don't even believe. Can you believe? We go and visit folk who are having, and we just sit there and we make the situation compounded and worse. Why? Because we do not understand what it means to speak life. We think we have to go with some script and read and come up with some catchy phrase. You know, we'll log in our Facebook, amen, somebody, and see what the word of the day is, and we'll go with that trying to encourage. Sometimes all you got to say is, I don't understand, I don't know what you're going through, but can you believe? I don't know, but I know God can. It's just that simple. It's just that easy. I don't understand the inner workings. And you know, the more you figure it out, the less faith you need. Amen. You'll sit there and start figuring and figuring and analyzing, amen, somebody, intellectualizing your stuff, and pretty soon you have no faith. And then you wonder why it doesn't turn for your good. Because we speak so much death. We speak so much, Lord help me. I'm going back. I'm sorry. I do have a tendency to rant. I do. But the power is in your ability to believe. Do you believe? See, that's why I say it can't be punitive. You got to stop seeing God as wanting to abuse you and beat you down and grind you into dust. That's not God. Matter of fact, I'm going to tell you the truth about it. That's really the devil. And so if that is your view of God, then actually your God just might. Yeah, that's the devil's job. To grind us and accuse us and put us in difficult circumstances. That's not God. And so if you believe that's your God, then it just might be. Mm-hmm. And so Jesus says, number one, can you believe? The question is tonight, what it's not, you know, you go around trying to get everybody to understand what you having to deal with and what you having to go. I don't, man, listen, I got my own. Yeah, one of the reasons why I think we preachers have such a hard time is we're a jack of all trades. We spend so much time trying to deal with everybody and understand what everybody else is going through and trying to, you know, to take on their cares and their concerns that we don't have time to deal with our stuff. I'm noticing that. Man, that ministry in L.A., man, that thing come home with me. Y'all don't understand what I'm talking about. Yeah, some of this stuff, we just got to teach folk to deal with some of their own stuff. I thought it's healthier that way. Man, you know, the stress kill, they say. And man, you keep letting people bring their stresses to you and ain't going to do nothing but say something kind about you while you're stretched out. And then the next guy come in, he'll pick up where you left off. Hey. They'll kill the next one too. Hey, well, anyhow. Amen. Can you believe, Jesus says? Now, with that in mind, now let's turn over to James chapter number 1. You know this passage. I'm not telling you anything you hadn't ever already heard. Now I'm going to give you this principle. Now, can you believe? Now, faith. Amen. It's the ability to believe and trust that God is going to do right by you. Now, I'm going to teach you that principle, Lord willing, but that probably won't come till Sunday. Because, see, now, once your faith is properly grounded and properly structured, properly put into its place, your faith puts you in a position to praise. I ain't going to get ahead of myself. Lord, have mercy. Let me give you this principle. Jesus says, can you believe it? Because if you can believe, all things are possible. Now, James chapter number 1 and verse number 5, you know this passage. If any of you lacks wisdom, that means if you lack anything. I know he's talking about wisdom in this context, but I'm letting you know that that is a spiritual principle that applies across the board. If you would ask God of anything, amen, somebody, not just wisdom, and understanding, not just that, but whatever you ask God for, there are some prerequisites that must be met. He says, if you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. Amen. Number one, you got to know where to go. Mm-hmm. Amen. You cut a whole lot of extra. Mm-hmm. You can stop wearing yourself out. You can stop going here, there, and everywhere. He says, if you lack, let him ask God, whatever you lacking, can you believe that God will give it to you? I'm going to show you something in just a second if the Lord says the same. Look at what he said, who gives to all liberally. I'm going to show you that too. God will give you way too much. God will give you more than what you ask for. Yeah, if you got a power in your faith, if you have a faith that is powerful, God will give you too much. I'm going to show you that. God will give you more than what you ask for. You ask God for a slice, God will be done gave you a loaf. Amen, amen. I stopped asking for a loaf. Now, because I understand that the same God who will give me the loaf can let me own the bakery. Y'all don't understand. Man, I prayed this prayer to the Lord. I taught the church this in California. They thought I was crazy. Well, that ain't nothing new. A lot of folk think I'm crazy. Amen. But I told them, I said, listen, I'm going to pray to God to make me a millionaire. Amen. I've been faithful over a few things. Me and my wife give good. Amen. Amen. I speak on my own. Amen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we do good. We believe in giving to the work. Amen. 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 And so I've been faithful over a few things. And Jesus says, you're faithful over a few. I'll make you a ruler. I'll entrust you. And that ain't in heaven. You ain't going to run nothing in heaven. So he ain't talking about heaven. I ain't going to run nothing in heaven. Amen. Your shepherding duties end at the graveyard. Amen, somebody. Amen. Your evangelism ends at the cemetery. Amen. I'm not ruling anything, and neither are you. And so what he's talking about is right now in this life. And so I told the church, I said, I'm praying to God to make me a millionaire. Now, I might can't handle a million. Ain't because I didn't ask for it. Matter of fact, it ain't because I don't believe he'll give it to me. Amen. I'll show you that in just a second. Amen. Amen. According to, you know, God know what I need. Amen. Amen. But I asked for it. Amen. Mm-hmm. But what he did was something so unusual. Right after I prayed that, Jay, he brought millionaires to the church. Y'all ain't heard me. I ain't got time to teach you the principle of the Hiram. Amen. But whenever the people of God get ready to build, God will send you a Hiram. Amen. He sent me two Hirams. Amen. Somebody going to say, well, one of them ain't a member of the church. That don't mean he can't help me in the kingdom. Amen. Somebody. I'm working on his soul. Amen. He helping me. Y'all don't understand. Y'all don't understand. Yeah. Well, maybe the answer that God gave me was that, you know, Chris, you ain't ready. But son, that don't mean I ain't going to answer your prayer because you believe me. So my answer was he sat two millionaires on the pew. Y'all didn't get that. Y'all didn't get that. Y'all didn't get that. I wanted the millions. Amen. Because I was going to do good. Amen. You know, to him that know it to do good and do it and not, to him it is sin. I know I got to do good with it. Amen. Amen. But it's just not my time. Amen. I don't think God is finished yet. He's just trying to, amen. I'm still proving to him that I'll be faithful over a few things. Amen. I'm not discouraged. I'm not disgusted. Listen, we need more folk in the church. Amen. Desiring to be millionaires. Amen. Amen. You can't go down to the bank, and need a building fund, and you roll watermelon cart down. Mm. Amen. 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 Listen. I want to challenge every father in here tonight. Pray for your financial prosperity of your home. Ask God for it. You know, quit trying to backdoor him. I'm going to teach you that too. We go through the back door too many times. Amen. And y'all know we as black folk, we don't want nothing to do with a back door. Amen. Amen. I'm not going through the back door. I belong in the house, so I come through the front door. Now, I don't have a large faith because I'm not trying to understand how God going to give it to me. I didn't say, Lord, you know, now that he's millionaire, now I got to convince him to put some change in my pocket. No, that's not what I'm doing. I just accept the way that God gave the blessing. Amen. That's all it is. Amen. Amen. If any of you lack anything, ask God. Ask God. I ask God for it. I ain't got no problem with it. I ain't ashamed. I ain't bashful. I'm not embarrassed. I asked him. I got a 3-year-old. Y'all just talking about. Listen. I'm too good to that 3-year-old. If you think it's possible for a daddy to be too good, that's me. I don't share with that 3-year-old. That 3-year-old is welcome to whatever I have. We don't have to share. Whatever I have is hers. I love chili cheese Fritos. Everybody at the church, because we have 10:30, and then right after that, we go into our 2 o'clock, and then I'm done. Well, I don't eat before I preach because I can't. It'll start trying to, amen, reveal itself. And so I will eat a little bit just to keep my strength. And so the church know that one of my favorite little snacks is either the apple fritter, or it's the chili cheese Frito. Well, guess what? Because my wife is real health conscious, my wife don't give the baby apple fritter. She don't give the baby, you know, chili cheese Frito. That's between her and her daddy. Now, as much as I love apple fritters and chili cheese Fritos, whenever that baby see me eating, it transfers ownership. It now becomes hers. I don't share with her. If I see her eating out the bag twice, they now hers. They yours, baby. Y'all don't understand. I go on and drop this now. I'm trying my level best to spoil her rotten. Because guess what? When it come time for some man to ask her for her hand, what we are doing, it is a relay. I am going to pass the baton, amen, somebody. And now it will be his job, amen, to pick up. I ain't shame mine. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. I ain't got no problem with it. You do with your children what you want to do with your children. Leave me and mine alone. Amen. But I'm doing my level best to spoil her. Amen, somebody. Because you know when you do that, you'll cut a whole lot of... She'll go trying to look for a man who care for her like her daddy. See, a man that won't care for her like her dad, he don't have a chance. I want it like that. Amen. I mean, I went off on a tangent, and I might as well pass this. And if he ever get tired of doing it, as long as I live, she can always come home to her daddy, and she will pick up where she left off. Amen. Now, that's just me. But I tried to point the picture. I'm trying to paint the picture for you. If I know how to be good, better than good to mine. Jesus says, what man's son ask him for fish and he give him a serpent, and he want bread and he give him a stone? Jesus says, if you being evil know how to be good to your children, how much more will your heavenly father be? If I'm that good to her, surely God gonna outdo me being good to me. And so I can ask him, and I believe that. I have no issues, no qualms about knowing that God give to me all the time better. Amen, somebody. Mm-hmm. God outdo me, and I'm going to show you that. I'm going to show you that out of Matthew chapter 6, verse number 33. I'm going to show you that, but not right now. But I'm going to show you that. Amen. Y'all make sure. Y'all tell me every night, show me that, show me that, show me that. And I'll do my best. And then he says, he'll give it to you liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But he said, let him ask. How? In faith. What takes the power out of your faith? What takes the potency out of your faith? It's your doubt. Can you believe? What minimizes your faith is you mix and intermingle the power with doubt. And he says, if you're going to doubt him, he says what? He says, doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his way. Now, double-minded man and unstable in all his way is just really a biblical way of saying he crazy. Amen. And Lord knows some of us are running around double-minded. Mm-hmm. Some of us are real unstable. Amen, somebody. Some of us are spiritually schizophrenic. Amen, somebody. Some of us got split personalities all in our faith. One day we'll ask, full of faith, and then the next day. And then God will answer the prayer. And rather than that becoming a foundation stone of your faith, you got to start all over again. Don't pass go. Don't collect 200. Amen. Amen. Don't collect your blessing, because you always starting all over again. Of all that you've seen of God working in your past, you ought to be able to trust him with your future. I know what God has done, and I'm trying to stop starting over all the time. That's some power, man. Quit being double-minded. being a crazy. Amen. I can't call you a Christian because I don't think Christians are crazy. Amen. I think members of the church are a little off, but not Christians. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Quit being double-minded. You know, they even show there is medical evidence that if when people are having medical issues, that if they believe they can be healed, the healing process commences. But all that is just in the Bible. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you know and believe God can heal you, the healing process will begin. Y'all gonna make me show y'all this. I was trying my best. Y'all, Lord help us. Go on. Greenville Avenue folk, y'all be all right. Okay, I gotta come in for a landing. I'm sorry. But I gotta show you this. Go on and turn with me to Daniel chapter number 10. I'm gonna go on and show you this, and then I'm gonna try to let it be. Because some of you are sitting there saying, well, you know, I prayed to the Lord and I believed it when I prayed it, but nothing happened. You know, I trusted in the Lord and I besought the Lord, you know, just like Paul. I sought the Lord 3 times. I had a thorn in my flesh. I had a problem I needed to deal with. And I went to the Lord and I besought his face 3 times and nothing happened. Well, Daniel chapter number 10, for emphasis sake, I'm going to go ahead and give you the rendering, and then I'm going to show you the I'm going to give you a peek behind the curtain. I still don't have time to really deal with this text, Brother Gibbs. Man. Well, anyway. Now, what's happening is that there is a problem. There is something going on. And Daniel, as the man of God, he has received a vision from the Lord. He understands something is going on with the people of God. And he wants clarity. There's an issue that he goes to God asking God to take care of and to help him in his understanding. Help him and bless him to be able to be comforted and have the peace of mind in the face of his adversity. Amen, somebody. And so God doesn't answer. And in the meantime, Daniel begins to do what we do. What happens? Daniel starts feeling like, well, maybe there's static on the line. If you know anything about the communication paradigm, what goes on between the sender and the receiver, receiving the message, is static. Amen. And so static distorts the message. And so what we do when we communicate, if I'm trying to talk to you right now and a loud noise is going on, what we'll tend to do, if you're trying to talk on your cell phone while you're driving, sometime what do you have to do? You can't hear because the static, amen. There's an interruption, there's an interference in you receiving the message, and so you'll turn your radio down. If someone's trying to talk to you and you can't hear what the person is trying to say, you'll start trying to quiet down the environment. Amen. And so here he is communicating with God and there's static on the line as he sees it. And so what he does, he fasts. Amen. He didn't have to fast, but he chose to fast, believing just like us that God would have answered me if there had been no static. You ever feel like that? Well, maybe there's some sin in my life. Maybe there's some things that I need to get right. Maybe there's some things out of whack. Maybe I need to, you know, Jesus said, if you bring your gift before the altar and you realize you have all, you know, don't offer. Amen. Don't make your offering before the Lord before you make it right. And so we'll start trying to arrange things. But I want you to know, sometimes you not getting the answer from God ain't got nothing to do with whether or not you have sinned. Now, I'm not saying don't evaluate and don't do a self-evaluation and make sure that you're in a proper position to be able to enter into God's presence and ask him for whatever it is that you have need of. Amen. You should do that. But that's not always your problem. That's not always. You may not even be the problem. And then I want you to know that God ain't sitting in heaven trying to think about what he's going to do either. God ain't trying to make up his mind. God ain't a man, so God don't have to make up his mind. God ain't got to mull it over. God is omniscient, meaning he's all-knowing. And when God is presented with it, he's already got it worked out. That's what make him God. So God ain't sitting up there trying to see whether or not, you know, let me look. Let me look at the holy record. Amen, somebody. Let me see. Amen. Day before yesterday. Amen, somebody. You know, you fell asleep. in the middle of your prayer and you didn't say in Jesus' name, amen. Hey. Y'all know how we are. Y'all know how we are. You know, I didn't, you know, I came 15 minutes late to Sunday school, if I came at all, amen. Somebody? Well, you know, you'll start thinking that God is sitting up in heaven with a record trying to, you know, realize your transgressions, and he's trying to evaluate, well, you were 60% good, and so therefore I will answer 60% of your request. No, that's not God. God's not punitive. And so what happens consequently, because there is a 21-day period from the first time that Daniel prays the prayer before he sees the messenger, the angel of God, 21 days pass. Now, what has happened in that period is just like what happens to us. How do you know that? Because when, I believe it's Gabriel, because he's typically the messenger of God. And so here we see the angel. You don't have to say it's Gabriel. I'm just saying, I'm using necessary inference, which is one of our, amen, hermeneutical principles. Amen, somebody, just in case you want to know if I do my homework. Amen. And so what happens is when the angel comes with the message, he does three things. Number one, he touches him. Obviously, just like us, Daniel must have felt out of touch. Amen. Somebody, because we go through what we go through and we feel out of sync, we feel out of sorts, we feel out of touch with the will of God. And so that's what God has to do. God has to touch us sometime just to let us know that, man, you really ain't out of touch like you thought. Amen. Then he tells him, you are beloved of God. Because sometimes when we go through what we go through, we start feeling like God doesn't really love us. Amen, somebody. That really we've done something and we've fallen out of favor with God. God doesn't really love us anymore because we've fallen and transgressed his will. Amen. And so what father wants to love a disobedient son? Amen, amen, amen. And so he tells him, you are beloved of God. Amen. Boy, I thought y'all would just feel kind of, you know, because everybody want to be loved. Amen. And the folk that tell you they don't want to be loved is the one want to be loved the most. Amen. Somebody, hit dog holler. Amen. Somebody telling you they don't need nobody. They telling you how much they do. Amen. Well, so he says to him, he says, listen, he touches him. Amen, somebody. Then, amen. Amen. Sometimes we need to feel like we need the touch of God. We need to make sure that we're where we need to be. And sometimes God will reassure us that we're not so bad after all, that we're not as far from him. Amen, somebody. We start quoting Isaiah, why in the God's ears deaf that he cannot hear is your sin. Well, he ain't listened to me, ain't answered me, so I must be in sin. Ain't got nothing to do with it. Well, why is his arm shortened? Because of my iniquity. Because he would have given to me what I asked him for and what I needed if I didn't have my sin in my life. Well, that might not be it at all. And so then, not only does he touch him, not only does he tell him he's loved, he also, amen, somebody, he tells him, stand up, which means he had bowed down to his circumstances. Amen, amen. You a child of God. Listen, you a child of power. Oh, I ain't got time to show y'all that tonight. You a child of power. Why are you acting impotent and powerless to deal with your stuff? You got a God who works his power through you. And so he tells him, stand up. And then he says to him, Daniel, see, the problem was, Daniel, is the king of Persia, the princes of Persia. Now, that there is metaphoric language for the devil. Mm-hmm. He's basically saying, I was trying to come to you all these 21 days. But guess what? The devil was doing everything he could to keep me from getting to you. Y'all didn't get that. It ain't that God. And then he says to him, he says, man, God heard you the moment you prayed. I've been trying to get the answer to you. But the devil been doing everything he can to keep me from delivering God's mail. Oh, boy, look at that. And so he says, I had to call back to heaven. Amen. I had to place a call. Amen. Somebody, thank God that the angelic host can place a call to the Father. And he says to the Father, send Michael. Amen, somebody. Send Michael. Get the devil out of my way. Amen. Boy, you don't want God to send Michael. You don't want God to send Michael. Amen. When Michael come through, amen, folk, some things start changing. Amen, somebody. And so it's not at all. You see, so he says to him, the reason why God hurt you, because you met the two conditions. There are two conditions that he lists right there. He says, number one, you understood that you needed to talk to God. You believed that God could. Amen. That's condition number one. And then he says condition number two, you stayed humble, which means when you gave it to God, you left it with God. See what the devil is doing. See, the devil, the name means accuser. And so when you look at the book of Job, what you see is why he's called the accuser. He goes before God and he levies accusations about God's people to their father. And so if he delays the mail long enough, boy, Lord, have mercy. How many times did you not get your mail because you decided not to be home? See, all the devil has to do is delay the mail for most of us, because when that happens, we'll start feeling, obviously God didn't, he didn't hear me, and God ain't gonna answer my prayer, and you know, woe is me, and so you start disconnecting yourself. Amen. You'll pick up and move. Amen. Don't tell nobody where to fall with your mail. Amen. Somebody. Amen. You come up missing. Now you're in the witness protection pro. Amen. Because you done choke, and that's all of that. He just tries to delay it long enough for us not to meet the conditions. Once you start believing, well, God ain't going to answer the prayer, conditions not met. Once you give it to him and give him a time limit, guess what? Conditions not met. That's your problem. That's your problem. Now, how does the power work? Well, it's quite simple. That power, it is actually the power of God. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above whatever we could ask or think. That's talking about your prayer life. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you ask or think, according to the power that what? Works through us. Oh man, Philippians chapter number 2, starting at verse number 12. You already know, work out your soul's salvation with fear and trembling. Work, cause you say, but you forget to look at verse number 13. Verse number 13, he says that the power of God works in and through us. You got access to all of that power from God, and you can't have enough faith and belief. Can you believe? See, I know God is able. Can you believe tonight that God is able? Can your faith speak for you on your behalf? Does it say that I believe in the power of God? Therefore, there's power in my faith. Oh, I could show you some more proof texts, but, you know, two is good. One is enough. Two show enough good. I just showed you power, power. And don't you know God wants to work that power through your life? God wants to wrought that power in my life. Don't you? 2 Corinthians chapter number 4. In verse number 7, he says that that power, that the excellency may be of Christ. In other words, God wants to wrought his power, work his power in our lives. You know why he wants to do it? So he can prove to us that the power is in him and not in man. So I was going a whole different direction. I'm sorry. I hope that, Lord help us. I hope that was that all right? Thanks, brother. I need somebody. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Yes, sir. Now, So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. And when you now look, amen, Romans 10, 17, now when you start looking at Hebrews chapter number 11, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, based upon the evidence of things not seen. But without faith, it's impossible to please Him. For he that comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek. And when you start dropping down and looking at Abel, and looking at Enoch, and looking at Abraham, amen, somebody, looking at Sarah, you start seeing people who had a powerful faith. That's what all that means. That those men and women chose to have a powerful faith that allowed God to work His power through their lives. You ever stop to think about maybe the reason why you and I go through what we go through is so that God can work His power in and through our lives? You ever thought that maybe your sickness, that God's going to get glory by working His power through your sickness? You ever think that your unemployment is so that God can show you that He and He alone is the provider of His children? Maybe the reason why you are by yourself, because maybe God's trying to prove to you that He's enough. It might not be as bleak and as grim as we make it out to be. But oh, I know that I got a God that if I have faith and the power to believe that He can, amen, somebody, He will give me what I ask for. So, he talks about the faith of a grain of a mustard seed. He talks about it in Matthew chapter number 11. They're facing a mountain, and he says to him, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, in other words, I can move any and all obstacles out of your way. All you got to do is have a powerful faith. You ain't got to have a big faith. It ain't got to measure up to the size of the mountain. Amen, somebody. You ain't got to muster up enough confidence, amen, to make your faith equal to your mountain. No. All it takes is a mustard seed. God, you can move this mountain. And whatever obstacles are standing in your way, Jesus says the way you get it out of your way is have the faith. Have power in your faith. And then he goes on record again in Luke chapter 17, verse number 5. He says to him, he says that you know, if you have the faith of a grain of a mustard seed, he says, you will say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted, amen, and cast into the sea, and it will relocate. Yeah, all that stuff that's down rooted in your life, amen. Well, my mama, the reason why I'm like this, because my mama did, my daddy, and my brother, and my sister, my family, all that stuff. If you have enough faith, powerful faith, that's the grain of a mustard seed, all of that stuff that's rooted down in your life that keeps you, amen, from, see, you can't grow, you can't grow anything productive, amen, somebody, because all of your garden is, amen, is rooted with stuff you can't use, amen. And so if you just have the faith as a grain of a mustard seed, if your faith is powerful enough, all your obstacles, God will move. All the stuff rooted in your life, God will move it. Amen. He's not punitive. He's not sitting up in heaven trying to punish you. God's not willing that any should perish. He don't want the most wicked man walking the face of the earth to be lost. That's just how. See, only God can be like that. I can't be like that. Oh, a lot of folk, I almost told on myself, amen. Yeah. But only God can still desire the most vile man walk in the face of the earth. God can still desire even him to come to repentance. So you trying to make him punitive? He's anything but that. God don't want to send one single soul to hell. If we wind up there, it is based on personal choice. We leave God no other alternative but to. And so, you know, Well, to those that need to come to the Lord, listen. If you haven't obeyed the gospel, this is your time and this is your opportunity. Let me tell you something. Why don't you have enough faith tonight? Why don't it be powerful enough tonight? You will not understand everything before you come. Amen. You ain't got to know everything and have everything added to your faith to be saved. Thank God for that. Amen. You don't have to understand all of the mysteries. Amen. Concerning the Bible, you don't need to know that. All you need to know is that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. John 3:16. Do you believe that? Jesus tells us, he tells us clearly, except you believe that I am he, you're going to die in your sin. John 8. Do you believe that tonight, that Jesus is the Son of God? Faith alone will not save. Amen. Amen. Got to add to your faith. Belief, that word right there, believe, is actually a word that is saturated with action. In other words, there's something you must do. Because of what you believe in your heart, it causes you to act. What is the action? Jesus tells us, I tell you, nay, except you repent, you're going to likewise perish. Luke 13:3, and again in verse 5. Do you want to change your life tonight? Don't you want to stop living with no hope? Don't you want to stop living without any help? Why don't you become a child of God tonight? You can make your mind up right now.
This message was brought to you by Mountain View Church of Christ. Visit our website at mtviewcoc.org for more information about what we're doing and how you can be involved in ministry and spreading the word of God. Believe, become, belong.
Come out to the Mountain View Church of Christ, mtviewcoc.org.